We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Good afternoon. Welcome to WDC Radio. I'm your host. I'm WDC. I want to thank you for listening in today. As always, we have a very spectacular, important show for you right here on LA Talk Live, WDC Radio. As you know, we just ended Sickle Cell Awareness Month, September. But as you know, on this show is dedicated to sickle cell trait awareness all year long. So we don't just do it for 1 month. So again, if you want more information about sickle cell trait, go to WDCONSCT.org. That's my organization where we take on the sickle cell trait conversation. I call it Aspects of Sickle Cell Trait because there are so many different conversations that we can have. And so I invite people here to come and share the experiences and their stories and their awareness and their information. And so last week we had a conversation about quality of life versus the cure. And how that conversation with, I had Dr. Maisha, who's going to be calling in shortly, who we talked about, you know, being human being, first of all, not even about the cure, just being human, and then living in what we call, some call the future of uncertainty. And I know that for a fact because I was depressed as I was getting out of the military. So I was so worried about my future that I became anxiety, worrying, and all that stuff would spiral me into a depression. And so being able to, you know, come out of that and look at life from a different perspective, it's like, you know, we live so far out and because we can't control situations and we want to like be in control of everything, but in reality, we have no control of, you know, really anything. But it's all about mindset and points of view and thought process and, you know, all our experiences and growing up, all that plays a part in how we view life and how we take on life. And so in September 18th, I was out at Loma Linda for their patient fair, health fair, and I asked the community, like, you know, a lot of people are focused on the cure, like, we got to find a cure. And I'm looking like, but what about today? Like, you're looking for a cure. What is your quality of life? And so I posed the question, like, what do you guys think? You know, am I off? Or what do you guys think about this, you know, this conversation of quality of life versus cure, where you can look, are we looking for a cure that so far out that today, you know, is your body going to be ready for a cure, you know, when they find that cure or not? And so there's so I was told that it wasn't far-fetched, that actually that's part of the mental conversation of, you know, living with sickle cell is how the mental aspect of it affects not just the patient living with sickle cell, but the family, of the worrying and the stress and all that that goes with it. So I just thought it would be a good conversation to kind of spark and get, you know, different points of view. We got a doctor's points of view. I have another caller here who has a psychology background. So, and she has sickle cell herself. So I wanted to like keep this conversation going because I feel it's important, not only for, you know, having sickle cell, but again, quality of life, I think, is really, if we have a good quality of life, I think when they find the cure, we'll be mentally ready for it. Whatever that is that, you know, that we call a cure. We know that the bone marrow transplant is a cure for some. It's not universal, but some people have, you know, have had progress and experience, you know, being cured from sickle cell with bone marrow transplant. So it's not that there is not a cure, but in the community, the conversation is, you know, it's not a universal cure. You have to have a match or a close match and all the different dynamics that go with, you know, having a bone marrow transplant. So I'm more, you know, even on my sports show, The Sports Sounds Live, when we have guests, you know, I talk about that mental, you know, that mental to me is very important because I thought my mind was strong, you know, being in the military and serving 24 years and all that. And then, you know, in my career, I thought was over. I thought my life was over. And that's what I made it mean. And I lived my life as it was over. And everything that happened to me was effective because my life was over. And watching, you know, being able to look at that now and again, come out of that, you know, I dealt with the future of uncertainty. And so I can only imagine what that is like for people who don't even have a disease, but just living life that, you know, you lost a job or whatever life brings. So here on WDC Radio today, I have I'm blessed to have some people here that's going to help me give their perspective, give their points of view, because I don't have all the answers. I'm not a doctor, but definitely an advocate for the sickle cell trait and sickle cell disease. And so this is my community. I had no idea there was a sickle cell community. When I found out I had sickle cell trait, I was at age 29 in the military, and the LA Air Force Base found it and called me in a panic, like, "Do you only have sickle cell trait?" I'm like, "No, this is what you do." But they gave me no information, no documentation, nothing. So in one ear, out the other, I knew I had a cousin that had the disease, but it still didn't put two and two together. And then in 2006, I was doing the physical fitness test and I collapsed. And it was related to the sickle cell trait called sickle cell trait exertion, which I didn't find out until 4 years after that. So I was living with sickle cell trait. I've had pain in my arm since I was five. They told my grandparents it was growing pains. So in this advocacy work, we're finding that people with sickle cell trait have complications as well that they're starting to pay attention to. So leading to all that is my life experience. I'm here today to help, you know, bring awareness to the trait, but also have this conversation. So I have some live guests. Let me turn the microphones on, 3 and 4. Say hello to the listeners.
Hello.
Microphone check. Don't be afraid. Pull that closer to you before I put you on camera. You're not on camera yet, so I want you to get your microphone situated. You ready?
Yes.
All right, I'm bringing you live on camera. So this is my guest. I have Kay Jackson, and I have Sierra Jackson, and they are here in the studio live, as you can see. So let me get this all set up. Let me bring my camera. Say,
hello,
clap,
hello, everybody. Hi.
Again, I want to thank you for accepting my invitation, for coming on the show. I know it was, you know, kind of a short notice today, but I appreciate you coming out and sharing your story. Shouts out to Nita Thompson.
Yeah,
who made the connection.
Hey, Nita.
And again, just thanks for coming out and having this conversation with us. Let me get the callers that are on the line situated here. You're live at What's the Count? My callers?
Is this my line?
Hi.
Hey, I got two callers. So 323, shout us out.
Hi, this is Crystal Smith calling.
Crystal Smith, how are you?
I'm pretty excellent, actually.
Thank you. Thanks for taking time out of your day to call in. Crystal was a guest here about 2013 when I first started here at LA Talk Live. She was a guest, live guest here as well.
I know Crystal.
You know Crystal? Crystal, do you know Sierra?
Tia?
No, Sierra.
Sierra. Oh, yeah. Hi.
Hi.
All right. All right. So we got, and then Dr. Maisha, is that you? Dr. Maisha?
Yes, it's me.
Dr. Maisha, how are you?
It's me.
I'm great. This is very exciting.
Yes.
Welcome
is.
To Tierra and is that the two Jackson women?
Yeah,
there,
the moms, the mom and daughter. We got the mom and daughter here. Yeah.
Thank Absolutely. You.
And they have a very, 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 very important conversation to share with us as well. And I think it fits in to what we're talking about, actually. Again, it's a true blessing because this was not set up. Shouts out to KC. KC was my guest who was in a crisis. He has sickle cell SC. So he's in a crisis. And so he was like, man, I can't make it. So I'm like, all right, KC, let me get to work. And so here we are. We're live. And so, Kay Jackson, can you just introduce yourself to the listeners and then we'll get this show started. How's that?
Hello, everyone. My name is Kay, and I have one daughter. Her name is Sierra, and she was born with sickle cell disease. I did not know that I had to.
You're just gonna go right in there. Okay. Just gonna take my. You're just gonna take it right. You see that? She's gonna go with it.
Okay. Hello.
Before we go there into the details, Sierra, please introduce yourself to the listeners.
Hi, everyone. I'm Sierra Jackson. Is that all I
That's
can
all
say?
That's all you have to say? I guess your mom already started it, huh? Thanks, Mom.
Uh-huh.
All right, so again, this show is dedicated to sickle cell awareness, sickle cell trait. I can't talk about the trait without talking about the disease because they go together, so you just can't leave one out of the conversation. They're two different subjects. However, they go together because, as we're finding out right now, you can have a child with sickle cell disease, so... Kay, I want to ask you, as you was leading into the answer already, were you aware that you had sickle cell trait?
No, actually, I'm a twin, and I was never informed about the trait until probably about 6 months into my pregnancy.
Wow.
I was told.
It's to y'all?
Yes. But it's a he.
Oh, it's a he? All right. Shouts out to him.
Hey, Chris.
Does he have the trait, too, or...?
Not
sure.
He said he did.
He said he didn't. Okay, it's possible because you know
right.
I was AS, so you inherit one gene from the parent.
That's right.
All right. So you find out you have sickle cell trait, right?
Right. 6 months. Pregnant.
6 months pregnant. So no knowledge. Did you know about sickle cell before the doctor?
You know what? Fortunately, God had prepared me for it.
Okay.
I have a medical background.
Oh.
And I worked with the adults with sickle cell for about 3 years. And I found out that at that time that the men seemed to suffer a lot more harsh. It appeared that way, at
okay.
least. And then I was able to work on a pediatrics unit. And I work with the children with sickle cell. So I probably got some training probably about 6 or 7 years
before
Sierra was ever
no
thought
kidding.
About and that kind of thing. So
that's awesome.
I was being prepared for this journey.
No doubt. And you have Sierra, you have sickle cell SS or SC? Do you know?
I have the actual disease.
Okay.
No, SS or SC.
SS.
SS, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and I just want to make sure I introduce, I know we got the guest, Crystal. Crystal, can you just introduce yourself to the listeners and then, you know, your background a little bit?
Sure. So sickle cell actually runs in my family. I have two family members that have the disease. So when I was diagnosed with the disease, my mother was already aware of what kind of effects it could possibly have on my life, and she knew that she had the trait pretty early on, so she was she was pretty prepared. I was cared for at Children's Hospital Los Angeles, and I've always been raised to be very outspoken and to speak up for myself, and so there was never really an option for me to not talk about it because I was sick so much as a kid growing up.
Yes.
And then once I transitioned into college, it was just, of course, talking to my professors and talking to my friends and associates and really raising awareness on campus within the African-American community, and then that kind of started expanding outside of campus and outside of the African-American community. So I was previously the executive director of the Sickle Cell Disease Association of America in San Diego, that San Diego chapter. And now I am currently in a doctorate of psychology program for organizational management and consulting, and a lot of my motivation behind that was because of the work I did with the Sickle Cell Association and seeing how much need was there and that need for more psychology, more mental health awareness just within having our disease. We need a lot of mental support.
Yeah.
And I didn't feel like that was a core priority within the national organization. And then it seemed like the local organizations didn't know where to start with something like that. Who has the training and expertise on combining chronic illness with mental health and how to live a positive and fulfilling life? And even at 22, I didn't know where to start with that.
Right.
So you
definitely fit this conversation. So again, thank you for your time. And one more, Dr. Maisha, just introduce yourself. You're a regular here, but let them know your background and who you are.
Hi, I'm Dr. Maisha. I'm a family medicine physician, and I'm also involved in sickle cell trait and sickle cell advocacy work. We are often the first stop, and we see the patients first. For me, watching people suffer with symptoms that they can't put together, not knowing what's causing it, and being made to feel like it's all in their head, and then coming to find out, oh, it's symptomatic sickle cell trait, and being able to help them has been a very rewarding experience. And being able to speak out and bring awareness to the fact that sickle cell trait can also crisis, and people with that need similar support as we begin to have this very important discussion that our future doctor there is talking about. So that's kind of my background.
Definitely. And again, this is, to me, you know, being with my depression, and part of that's my retirement from the military. I've been doing a lot of work just in personal development, and the mental health, as she mentioned before, is, to me, is important. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to, you know, talk to my guest here, to Sierra. When you think mental health, what do you think about as it relates to sickle cell personally?
Well, what do I think about mental health? Well, I was born with sickle cell SS, and I went through a lot of pain crises growing up. Mm-hmm. My crises started probably when I was about age 6 or 7, and then they started to really get bad as I was going through junior high and high school. And being in and out of the hospital that often, and having pain from my head to my feet, not being able to walk, and just screaming at the top of my lungs, that it can really cause severe depression. Yeah. Because you can't understand why is my body in this much pain. And not only does the disease itself cause that sort of depression, I think that the treatment plans that I was offered, the amount of narcotics that I was offered, can also have a huge effect on your mental health, because you can have drug dependency, which can affect you. And it was very difficult to understand why I had to go through that kind of pain.
Definitely. Mom, you know, you mentioned before that you worked with sickle cell patients before you had your daughter. What was that, you know, seeing that quality of life in the hospital, you know, what were you thinking?
Well, I'm so glad that I was prepared to some degree in how to take care of Sierra and how to fight for her. It's a community thing, because one minute is so misunderstood. One minute, I mean, she looks good, and next thing you know, she's on the ground screaming uncontrollably. And her peers, they've always misunderstood it. Her school teachers, they didn't know what was going on with her. Because she'd be fine, there would be no warning or whatever. Next thing you know, they're calling the ambulance, she's screaming, she's in crisis, she's been fine all day.
Right.
It's just a whole combination of factors there. There needs to be some more education in the hospitals, in the schools, because it's the disease is like deceitful.
We know that, you know, and it seems to be a common conversation across the country that the nurses play a real key in the care of our sickle cell community. Like, that is like the person that if compassion is missing, or trust or anything like that is missing with that patient and nurse, then anything is liable. to come out of that, you know, out of that experience at the hospital. So you being a nurse, you know, some people aren't taught compassion. Like, right. You have to be taught sometimes how to be compassionate, how to be caring, even though you're in that field. Mm-hmm. You know, what can you say to that? Because that's, again, that's a struggle I hear with the community. Like, I don't want to go to the hospital because of my previous experience. So they're living in that already. Mm-hmm. When I go to the hospital this time, like, I don't want to go because of past experience. So the past is in the future of that experience. So as a nurse, you know, what could you say to
that? I would say you really have to try to have a good attitude in this, because you cannot fight this in your own strength. Mm-hmm. And you're going to come across a lot of ignorant professional personnel that have no idea in what they're doing.
Yeah.
So it's good that you keep a record. You, when your loved one is going through crisis, for you also to be aware of what's going on. Look at their bodies. Know what their hemoglobin and hematocrit, what their counts are. Yeah. And you also have to have an outlet for yourself. A walk or whatever. Journaling is very good. You just really need to do your own work and research to benefit in managing sickle cell. It's a chronic disease, and if you're in the hands of the wrong people,
it's an individual disease, because, again, this community, the commonality or the reality of it is the pain, the crisis, the medication, the transfusions, but it's really an individual.
But I just to interject, I would also say that I think that there is a lack of education in the medical field when it comes to sickle cell. Mm. You know, it's a genetic disorder, right. And I can't tell you how many times I have been in the hospital and they say, when did you get diagnosed with this? When did you get it?
Yeah.
And I think that there's just a really big lack of understanding about the disease. And I think that the root of that problem is education.
Definitely. Okay. So for my callers, who wants to first talk about? Crystal, that's you, right?
No, it's me. It might be me. Is it me?
Is she still there?
This is Dr. Maisha. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you. Okay. So I want to find out.
I just want to comment on something she said about education.
Okay, go ahead.
Very briefly, you're absolutely correct. We had one morning lecture about sickle cell and sickle cell trait in med school, in 4 years of med school.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's pretty
it's crazy.
Much. So we're talking about the background of as far as the mental health aspect of it. So I want to, from what you learned in your education between the two of you, what, you know, everybody's not spiritual, you know,
right.
So we don't have, a lot of people don't go to prayer and things like that. So we're talking about, you know, the person who is living with these, just the human being functions. You know, and there's a lot of education back, you know, that people could have learned. So, Dr. Maisha, can one of you kind of like share, as far as, you know, there's so many different theories and things like that. Like, what did you, you know, how can you share that with the listeners?
I'm not sure if I fully understand the question, but are you saying how do we explain what sickle cell is?
Like, let me say, Crystal, is Crystal still there? Let me talk. Let me ask Crystal.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, so you live with sickle cell, and you've got into this field, you know, like you mentioned, particularly because you've seen something that was missing in there. What?
Right.
So, how do you share that with your education? You know, how do you apply that to yourself, knowing now that you have these education background and the theories and, you know, whatever that is that you, you know, learned, you know, from it, how do you apply it personally?
Well, it took a long time for me to be able to apply the theory, because I became a psychology major because I knew I was dysfunctional and I wanted to try to get some sense of order and balance. So first it was just, you know, personally, I wanted to do things better and do things differently. And then as I started becoming more confident in myself, then it was, oh, so this is how I can apply this to, you know, keeping a positive perspective, even when I'm in, you know, intense pain,
right.
Or I'm in a hospital and I have to argue with a nurse and I have to think back, like, okay, I know that if I approach this way, this is not going to turn out good. I'm going to end up being in more pain because I'm frustrated.
Right.
So in order for me to keep myself from going from a 15 to a 20, even though the pain scales only go from 1 to 10, the truth, pain can go way beyond 10 when you're in a serious crisis on top of having to deal with, you know, personal issues or family issues or arguing with nurses,
right.
or whatever it is. So constantly being conscious and aware of how my own emotional state,
right.
and my own thought process are affecting my pain level was motivation for me to go, okay, you know what? I need to figure out a different way to deal with this or to cope with this. So when I'm sick, I watch a lot of comedy. It was actually something I saw on a documentary called The Secret. A woman had cancer, and one of her coping mechanisms to get through chemotherapy was watching a lot of comedy.
Right.
So you're not sitting there in this state of sadness and you know, horror and why me?
Right.
So I just constantly was just looking for ways to pull myself out of that, and in that came me writing my sickle cell poem that I performed, like, I don't know how many times, mm-hmm. which is essentially no more woe is me. Yes, I'm in pain. Yes, this sucks. Yes, this is something I have to deal with, but I have to deal with it, and I want to deal with it in a way that I can still live a happy life. And
right.
when those moments happen, I'll deal with it when it happens, but let me not sit in this negative space, because when I'm negative and I'm depressed and I'm sad, I get more crisis. I get pneumonia. I get a whole slew of other issues versus when I'm in a more positive space, or at least when I'm trying to
right.
be in a more positive space.
And so when you hear, you know, the question that I posed, you know, earlier to you, you know, quality of life versus cure, you know, what do you have to say about that?
I think absolutely, because at the end of the day, you know, there's been many theories that there is already several different cures. We just don't have access to them because of the current medical systems, right?
Mm-hmm.
We know how our medical system works in America. They're not looking for cures for diseases. They want to make money
yeah.
off of diseases. So with that being said, we don't really live in a system where a cure for a common cold is even accessible for the average everyday person. So instead of me sitting around waiting for a cure and asking, let me figure out how to live a good life right now.
Yeah.
And that's really what I've dedicated myself to over the last, I'd say, 3 or 4 years. And I'm not that old. I'm only 25. I'm not, you know, the all-knowing. I just know I have a whole lot more life to go through.
Yes.
But based on where I am right now, I'm not even interested in, you know, writing letters to the president to get a cure. I'm like, for what? They're not going to give it to us.
Yeah.
They make too much money off of us.
Yeah.
So I might as well pick something different, choose something different.
And when you hear, you know, the future of uncertainty, have you noticed, you know, in your life where you live so far out that you can tell when that anxiety starts to get created because you're living in this future of uncertainty? Have you experienced that before?
I'm trying to, are you saying that because I don't know, like, what the future holds, that I find myself getting more creative or finding other ways to deal with that?
For some, you know, because the future is uncertain, creates anxiety for some. Some people, you know, we worry about what's going to happen tomorrow, and we're so focused on tomorrow that today is all, you know, out of whack.
Right. Well, I mean, depression is typically thinking about everything that you don't have, and anxiety is typically thinking about what you don't know. And I don't believe in focusing on what I don't have or what I don't know, because it does absolutely nothing for me.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, I'm like, what mental state do I need to be in to keep myself from getting sick?
Yeah.
If anxiety kept me from getting sick, I'd probably be severely anxious. But it doesn't.
Right.
It makes me sicker.
Right.
So I just choose not to think about it. I choose to go out here and be productive and live and try to contribute and try to give something, leave something behind. So I don't know if I'm going to be here at 26, but I don't really care, to be
right.
completely honest with you, because
what I'm doing right now is fulfilling right now. Yeah. And I hope that if something were to happen to me between now and tomorrow or between now and 26, that I've left something meaningful behind. That's what matters. That is what is most important to me. Right. There have been many studies done globally that have done surveys and research on what is the meaning of life for people. And this is a global research. It's not just an American a research topic. And one of the things that people globally have said is they want to contribute. Not that they want to be rich, not that they want to live to be 100, none of those things. They want to contribute.
Yeah.
So as a person with a chronic disease, I think it's important for us to figure out what we contribute while we're here.
Yeah.
That way you're not focused on the past. You're not focused on what you don't have right now. You're not focused on what tomorrow's going to bring. What can you do right now to contribute to the world that you live in?
And I agree with you. I think that most human beings have that within them, that selfless service, that they want to be a contribution to whatever it is, feeding homeless or whatever that is that fulfills you. I think every person has that inside of us. Sometimes it just gets distorted again by worrying about what's happening on in life, that gets, you know, that is not the number one subject that we want to talk about. So I know I got to be mindful of your time. Anything else you want to share or say about this conversation about quality of life versus the cure? Anything you want to share?
I just feel like I want to say that we should not be so focused on death, but at the end of the day, death is a very real reality for human beings, and it's even more of a reality for people with chronic illnesses, and especially ones that aren't as well researched or as well funded as sickle cell. But at the same time, I just feel like there's nothing we can do between now and tomorrow that's going to change that. We can plan for a long time. We can invest for, you know, the next generation of sickle cell patients.
Yeah.
But right now, I think we need to spend more time encouraging sickle cell patients to use their experiences for empowerment and to invoke change and to inspire people.
Definitely.
That if nothing else has given me motivation and inspiration over my 25 years of dealing with bullying, being told that I'm faking, mm-hmm. and all of the crazy things that sickle cell patients have to deal with, it's me being able to wake up in the morning and go, I've made a contribution. And it's not a whole lot, but I've left something.
Yeah.
And that is enough.
All right. Again, thank you for your time. I really appreciate you for calling in and sharing your insight. Much success to you, okay?
All right, I'll talk to you soon.
All right, thank you.
Bye-bye.
All right, so I'm going to go back to my live guests here, Sierra and Mrs. Kay Jackson. When you listen to Crystal, you know, what do you hear as far as quality of life versus cure?
Well, it's a good thing that she is fortunate and strong enough to do what she does, mm-hmm. but I've always shared with my daughter with sickle cell, it has caused me a lot of grief.
Okay.
A lot of pain and suffering for the caregiver.
It impacts the whole family.
Yes, it does. Yeah. The school and whoever is involved with the person that's suffering.
Yes.
There just needs to be more support, I believe, and more education.
When you say education, you know, because we say education, but what do you know from your perspective, especially being a nurse,
mm-hmm.
what education would you say, like 1, 2, 3, like what type of education is it?
Okay,
book knowledge, you know, more experience, face to face experience.
Both. Number one, what they do screening for all newborn babies.
Yes.
And the minute that you find out that your child has sickle cell mm-hmm. or any type of chronic disease, I just believe there ought to be some type of
genetic counseling or something.
Yeah, genetic counseling and stress management for the patient and the family, like. When they get their immunization shots, or there ought to be some requirements for anyone that is born with a disability, mm. because stress is a factor in pain episodes or when they're suffering.
Exactly, it's a
absolutely.
Trigger.
Yeah. So you know, if at a young age, if you can learn how to manage stress, and that's in the mind,
yes.
a lot of it, I think that they will be more successful in managing their disease.
Yeah, we had a conversation on another show about that. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you know, the Caucasian community, they'll send their kid to therapy right off the top, like right. 5, 6 years old. Little Johnny is in, right. he's got therapy. Mm-hmm. But our community and Hispanic community, we don't talk about that. Mm-hmm. So we were talking about this, and it's like, we wait till we're adults to go back and try to...
The damage is already
yeah,
done.
Yeah, the damage, it's like, how can we be proactive, like you're saying, yeah. and introduce that, you know, in the beginning of that
right,
conversation.
The beginning of life.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely. I mean, they would live longer, you know, just to have the follow-ups and how they're managing, because it's important.
Yeah.
It is. You know, when you're suffering in pain, and we've all had some type of pain, so,
yes.
but can you imagine just day in and day out and being misunderstood? Yeah. No, I could not imagine.
Yeah. Let's talk about that, Sierra. Like, you know, your mom is expressing, you know, how she saw you feeling, but you felt the actual pain. So what, give us.
Yeah. Well, when we're talking about living with the disease versus, the cure. I agree with Crystal. I do. But for me, my crisis and my experience with sickle cell was affecting my life. I was missing school. I was missing out on so much life opportunity because I was constantly being kicked around having to be in the hospital when I didn't plan on it.
Right.
And even in my social life, you know, it's embarrassing to be like screaming in pain in front of all of your friends because
right.
like 1 minute you're fine and the next you're in so much pain. So, you know, I do agree with Crystal. Like, this is a money-making industry.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But at the same time, you know, I don't know if you know, I had a bone marrow transplant.
Yeah, I was going to lead into that. So
okay.
That's why I said you were perfect for this conversation because of your experience. So.
Yeah, I have to say that I had my transplant last year, last May, and it was very rough. I had an allogenic marrow, which is an unrelated match. Mm. It was somebody from over in the UK.
Wow.
And it was a rough road.
Yeah.
I was in the hospital for about 10 months and in and out. I suffered from chronic GVH in my stomach. And there's a lot of complications that can come with the transplant. But I have to say, being 1 year out, I'm still dealing with some things. I am very grateful mm-hmm. that I was able to get the transplant.
Yeah.
I have gone to the beach and jumped in an ocean
yeah.
of cold water, something that I could never do before.
Yeah.
And I have started going to hot yoga. I could never get in a sauna.
Wow.
I would have a pain crisis or have a stroke, you know. And for me, I know she's saying that death is inevitable.
I mean, it's a reality.
Everybody's going to
yeah,
face death.
It's a reality.
But to me, I hated the uncertainty of not knowing if I was going to be around. I hated the uncertainty of feeling like, oh my gosh, like I want to get married. I want to have kids. I want to have a career. I want to do this. I want to do that. But I'm being bullied by sickle cell all the time. So I have to a little bit disagree.
That's
I don't think that you can really... For me, I could not focus on my life when I felt like I wasn't going to be around.
Right.
I didn't feel like I had hope because I felt like, oh my gosh, like sickle cell is going to take me away.
Right.
Like it's not going to be here. And I don't know if you're familiar with Natasha Taylor, but yesterday she passed away just a couple months ago. It was completely unexpected. I don't really know the details of her passing away, but I know that there was some things that probably shouldn't have happened when she was in the hospital. So
mm-hmm.
I really think that nurses and doctors, they need to be giving, they need more education on this disease. And furthermore, because this is a disease that affects people of color, I think that there is this stigma that we are just looking for drugs.
Yeah.
And that's a huge thing too. You know, we have to get away from, okay, well, this is a black disease. These people are just looking for drugs. There just has to be more education. And people sometimes think that just because it's a disease of color that we are the minorities looking for a fix.
Yeah. The stigmas.
Yeah.
I mean, the stigmas, you know, I call them inherited conversations because, you know, how I explain it is, you know, you're born into this world with
right.
no language
right.
as a baby. So you get language in your experience, in your environment.
Right.
And
right.
But that conversation about sickle cell has been for centuries. And so how do you go against that conversation when it already exists in the world as a, you know, in language? You know, you either become a rebel or you become, you know, a victim or part of that myth or that stigma.
Right. And, you know, when you're born with sickle cell disease and you go in the hospital so many times, you start to know what concoction of drugs work for you.
Yes.
And so I know when I would go in the hospital, it was so bad. My pain crisis, they would be so bad. And I knew exactly what I needed, but I would even refrain from saying what I needed because they would think that I was a junkie. And it's like, oh, she wants Benadryl with Dilaudid. Right. Like, she wants the perfect high. You know, like that is living like that and being in so much pain and not being able to voice what you need is sickening. And it's horrible. And it can make you depressed. And I lived in a world where I didn't feel like anybody could relate to what I was going through, you know? So I feel like my quality of life, I'm still dealing with some challenges from the transplant itself, but with, you know, I'm doing some acupuncture and some other Chinese things, Chinese practices that might help me. But I think that it outweighs me having that disease.
How young are you?
I'll be 28 in November.
All right, boom. All right, Dr. Maisha, you there?
Yes, she's touching on all of the topics.
I know. That's why
really,
I said
really
this is. I know.
It's like a marathon show.
I know. This is. I mean, that's why I know we're on point in life.
It.
We're on point in life because she's here with her life experience. I want to ask you, Dr. Maisha, you know, as a doctor, right? As a from your doctor hat.
Yes.
With the complaint of being drug seekers, that is, again, another common conversation across the globe in our community. How can we express this, educate the medical field? If the person knows that they need Benadryl and Dilaudid that will help their pain, and it may be a high dosage of both or whichever, like, why is that such a challenge?
I'm so, I am so beyond fed up with this problem. And the attorney general, he clearly has no one with sickle cell in his family because he just made it worse. They just put out the, you know, the chronic pain management guidelines. So everyone thinks that doctors are purely motivated by money. Most doctors have a set salary wherever they work. So whatever they do or don't do for you doesn't change the paycheck that they take home, typically speaking.
Yeah.
So the doctors, it's not about money, but it is about licensure and medical boards and peer review boards and not going against the grain because you could lose this career that you have mortgaged, meaning, you know, when you go through med school, when you get out on the other end, you're paying a mortgage.
Yeah.
But you can't afford to lose your career. There are doctors who just want to walk away from medicine but don't because they can't afford to walk away. You're basically stuck. So it's what's very scary to me is you're going to see this problem get worse and you're going to see more sickle cell death because physicians are scared to prescribe narcotics with the guidelines that have just come out regarding narcotics, with the blame being placed on physicians for killing people with narcotics.
Right.
Saying because we prescribed the narcotics and then someone overdosed, they died. Well, when someone dies from their ACE inhibitor, you know, an ACE inhibitor is like lisinopril for high blood pressure, for instance. When someone dies from their ACE inhibitor, no one blames the doctor for ACE death. You know, they say, well, this person had a reaction we weren't expecting, and so they died.
Right.
You know, and with ACE inhibitors are actually a really great example because you can have a patient that's been on an ACE inhibitor forever and done just fine. And then one day they get something called angioedema. The lips and throats all swell up. And if that reaction's not caught in time, the person could die.
Wow.
No one blames the doctors for that. See, there's no way to know. But when someone takes their narcotics incorrectly or this particular time, the same dose of their narcotic killed them, the doctors are blamed. Everything that's happening with narcotics, you know, prescription narcotics in this country has been blamed on the physicians. And then the next move has been to limit effectively limit how physicians can prescribe it. Right. So that's one big problem. The other problem which she's dealing with has to do with that inheriting conversation that you spoke about. Basically, the image of people of color, frankly, sickle cell does affect people of color far more than anybody else. We know that.
Just the facts.
And it's a disease that causes pain. So you're getting a disease that causes terrible pain in a people for whom there's a stigma that they are all drug addicts,
yep.
that they are all prostitutes and drug addicts and pimps and robbers.
Yep.
And this is the image that's been put out about our people. And this is what people grow up believing, even if it's subconsciously.
Yeah.
And changing that is going to be very, very difficult and a very long road.
That's a conversation we can have forever.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I could just come on the air every week and just say, it's not, they're not drug seekers for 2 hours.
Right.
And it would take 5 or 10 years before it clicks in the minds of the community that, oh, man, wait a minute.
It will take longer than that.
Right. You see what I'm saying?
It will take longer than that. It's going to take one person at a time, getting to know one person at a time and changing that image, because it's very powerful with these images being constantly flashed across the screen from when you're a baby.
Yeah.
You're talking about, you know, I wish the our psychology PhD candidate was still on the line, because I think we need to ask her, you know, a question I would ask her is, can you talk to us about how to change these deep-rooted subconscious beliefs that people have? Because that's what you're talking about. And, you know, there are some physicians out there, such as myself, that if you came to me and you told me, you know, 10 milligrams of Dilaudid, you know, with 50 milligrams of Benadryl every 6 hours, usually does the trick, I would give it to you. You know, there are certain telltale hallmarks of drug seekers.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you can kind of weed through that, you know. And everyone gets that first few visits with me before I make that decision, even if the chart says that they're a drug seeker.
Right.
Because I don't always believe that, you know. And I just am very sad that you could not speed up the process of getting the treatment that you needed. I think it's Sierra Jackson.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
You know, because of the ignorance and the bias and the bigotry that's rampant among my colleagues, you know, and it really just depends on who you encounter when you get there. So I think actually having these conversations, you know, people seeing you when you're well and when you are doing things and making it happen and realizing that, oh, she doesn't like to be on large amounts of opioids.
Right, exactly. Like, oh, yeah. See, oh, quality of life is different when you're not in pain. Like, so that's what I'm saying. So there's got to be.
Right.
Saying, you know, I actually heard at a seminar, they were saying, I was treated at CHLA for many years too. And we were saying that maybe patients could take the time to go to an emergency room in their local area during a time when they're not in pain crisis, so that the staff could be like, oh, like, this is you,
like,
on your day-to-day.
Exactly.
Like,
oh, you're not a cracked out.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, I was a student at UCLA, and I remember I had to go over to the emergency room, and I'm not bashing it, but they treated me kind of poorly one time when I was in the emergency room, and I was like, I'm a student here.
Right.
You know, I study, I get good grades, and I think that could be important too for patients to say, okay, I might be frequenting this hospital, and this is who I am,
right.
And sometimes I get these pain crises out of the blue, and this is me.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to take a quick break. Dr. Maisha, don't go anywhere. I'm going to play my PSAs over here, and then we'll be right back again. This is WDC Radio. I'm your host from WDC. Again, I want to thank you for listening in. Information about sickle cell trait, go to WDCONSCT.org. Follow me on Twitter, Instagram, @IMWDC. It's October 1st, and we're still talking sickle cell right here on LA Talk Live. That's what the show is dedicated to. We talk about sickle cell traits, sickle cell disease, thalassemia, mental health, bullying. Whatever that community outreach is, whatever your cause is, you're more than welcome to come here and share that with me on this platform. We help educate, you know, our listeners. We got over 9 million viewers here on LA Talk Live. We got 401,000 that watch the show here at WDC Radio. So I'm just blessed to be here to help get this message out and do my part as a contribution to our community. So keep it right here. Again, WDC Radio. I'm your host. Be right back.
Sickle cell disease is projected to become a leading cause of disease burden, mainly due to the expected growth in the prevalence as more people are living longer due to improved treatments and advances in research. The Foundation for Sickle Cell Disease Research uses a collaborative care plan model focusing on improved self-monitoring and medication adherence, and partnering with the Medic Alert Foundation to deliver crucial health information to first responders. We work smarter and better, as patients and families deserve the very best that our health care and social service systems have to offer. This means better health outcomes and well-being for those with sickle cell disease. This is Dr. Lynetta Bronte, and this message is brought to you by the Foundation for Sickle Cell Disease Research. Contact us at 954-397-3251. Again, that number is 954-397-3251.
Did you know sickle cell disease is the most common genetic disorder in the world? In fact, millions of people are affected by sickle cell across the globe. Don't you think that a disorder of this magnitude deserves more attention? Get educated. Create awareness today. This ad was sponsored by Sickle Cell 101 Education Plus Awareness. Please visit sc101.org. That's sc101.org to learn more.
What would your life be like if you needed blood transfusions every 2 or 3 weeks just to survive? And if you had to worry about all the iron from that blood making your heart and liver shut down? That's just what life is like for a person with thalassemia. If two people who each carry the trait for thalassemia have a child, there's a 25% chance with each pregnancy that the child will have thalassemia. For more information, visit the Cooley's Anemia Foundation at www.thalassemia.org. That's thalassemia. Or call 212-279-8090.
There is an inherited gene in our community that many have forgotten. The name is sickle cell trait. Prevention. The only way to find out if you carry this inherited gene called sickle cell trait is to get tested. This test is being offered by Medilab Company. For more information, call 760-600-5825 or email at medilabco@icloud.com. And according to What's the Count? 1 out of every 500 African-American births are sickle cell, and 1 out of 36,000 Hispanic children are born with sickle cell anemia as well. As far as sickle cell trait, 1 in 12 African-Americans inherit the gene. Find out more information about sickle cell trait, go to www.wdconsct.org or call Medilab Company at 760-600-5825 and help us find out what's the count.
This is SCTD on WC Radio. You are now listening to What's the Count Radio. Stay tuned for more information on LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Give me the green light. Give me just one night. I'm ready to go right now. I'm ready to go right now. Checking your smile, working your back like you just going out of style. Shake just a little bit faster, shake just a little now, girl.
Welcome back to WDC Radio. Again, I'm your host. I'm WDC. I want to thank you for tuning and listening in. Like I said, this is a very important conversation to our community. Just to listeners, we're out to educate everybody globally. You know, we can talk amongst ourselves. And I think that also helps because even our own community has their own views about sickle cell itself. So, well, what better way to have this conversation as a community, but also to help educate people who are listening as well about sickle cell trait, sickle cell disease, sickle cell anemia. You know, just it's just important. And I'm blessed to be able to do sickle cell trait screening. As you heard, I partnered with Medilab. So if you want information about sickle cell trait testing, I'm providing it mobily at wdconsct.org. I've been blessed to have that grant. So I'm doing my work in the city of Fontana, doing free testing and briefings in Fontana. And hopefully we're going to be spreading that around the community more, and again through California. So I started in my own backyard in the city of Fontana, got that grant. So we've done briefings and screenings, and September was just off the chain. I had a great time being able to help make that difference. People being tested, and it's just not normal. We tried to find some organizations in 2011 to come out and do sickle cell trait testing, and we couldn't find not one. And before my mentor, Phyllis Zachary Thomas, passed away, she came out here, and we, like I said, we couldn't find not one in 2011. So I knew that was on me to be responsible for that, and that was my work. So I took that on, and she passed away, and I still do this work, and she helped me, taught me how to be this advocate that I am today that you see. So I'm just blessed to be able to do my part. Having sickle cell trait and having my complications and awareness, I get to do all that. And it just helped make a difference. Like she said, to be a contribution is priceless. There's nothing like it, helping others. So, Dr. Maisha, are you still there?
Here. Okay. I'm here.
All right. So,
absolutely.
So, again, this. Go ahead. You got it. Go ahead.
Yeah. I was also reflecting on the mother's reaction to what the psychology student was saying. What was her name?
Crystal.
Miss Jackson was reaction to what was the name of the psychology student?
Crystal.
Oh, yeah. Crystal.
Crystal.
Yeah.
What Crystal was saying, I think it's a very interesting dynamic when you feel like even though you're trying hard that something is beating you, and people are telling you just try harder. Yeah. And so I think we want to make it really clear that when we deal with the future of uncertainty, it's not it's okay that in that moment when things are terrible, if you can't do it, just capturing the moments when you can and making the most out of it. Which is, I think, when she said the idea about going and meeting the people at the local hospital that may end up having to take care of you when you are in a crisis. Yeah. And I think that's a very important aspect of education. And to eventually, I envision a time when we have a grant or funding or connection to go into the medical schools and the nursing schools and teach at that level before they get out into their residency.
Oh, it's time.
To help them understand the depth of the disease and what's really going to be required in taking care of those patients.
Yeah, I have a college course at San Bernardino Valley Community College on the human services called sickle cell traits. So I've been teaching that 2 years in a row now.
Oh,
so what she's saying is it's time for our community. It's time for us to get into those medical colleges, those nursing schools, and give them some real live faces and conversation,
yeah.
Not just with the book. Like right. In my class, I do PowerPoint presentation, but I also bring a live person so that a person with the trait and a person living with the disease, so they can actually sit and listen and talk and ask questions to those, mm-hmm. People living with these, chronic illnesses. So it's got to be done.
Yeah.
It's got to be. It's time.
Yeah.
Like it's time. So, Sierra, you are a blessing to this conversation. Honestly, you've the quality of life versus the cure. Like you lived it. I mean, like I said, to be able to have the bone marrow transplant and to live with sickle cell and have the transplant. What is it like today living with sickle cell?
Well, I don't have it anymore. I don't have it anymore. I mean, I have a lot of avascular necrosis in my bones, mm-hmm. in my feet and my knees, which is very painful. And I didn't have it before the transplant, but they're like, maybe the sickle cell caused it. But I think that it's because of the high amount of steroids and the chemotherapy that I went through that caused it.
Yeah.
But I'm loving life. Yeah. I'm so excited. I'm just doing everything that I was not able to do before. I mentioned earlier, I've jumped in the ocean. I'm doing hot yoga. I applied to be a flight attendant and got the job. I would have never qualified for that position if I still had the disease. So It's also a little bit of psychological issues I'm having to deal with. When I said that I went out and jumped in the ocean, that was...
You put your toe in first?
Yes.
You're like, let me test the water first. Let me put my pinky toe in.
I still have so many psychological scars of thinking cold water equals pain.
Right.
You know, too much heat equals pain. So I'm still dealing with those things that I had to deal with from before, trying to overcome those issues. But yeah. I'm loving life, and I tell people social media is so powerful because I used my social media to have a voice about sickle cell. And you know, when I post a photo of me going through the transplant, I put like hashtag BMT, hashtag sickle cell. And I've actually had families reach out to me and ask me, oh my gosh, I'm trying to figure out if I want to do this transplant or not. And what I tell people when I've had the opportunity to talk to them, I've told everyone, you know, it's definitely an individual decision, but whatever you do, you have to be at peace with that decision, because if you choose to live with the disease and if something were to happen, you have to be okay with that.
Right.
Because I actually want to also mention that when it comes to sickle cell, it's very difficult to do the bone marrow transplant. They either want to do it because they don't want to do it because they're saying, oh, you're too far gone now.
Right.
Your body won't tolerate it.
Right.
Or it's, oh, you're not bad enough. We can just put you on hydroxyurea.
Right.
So it's definitely a fine line to getting it. But what I tell families when they're looking at the bone marrow transplant is I say, you have to be at peace, because the moment they put that chemotherapy in your body, you can't turn back.
It.
Like, it's a done deal. You have to get the transplant, and you have to deal with whatever problems come with that.
So, Mom, come on. Were you in this decision-making process here, or did she make it on her own?
Yes, I was. I supported it.
Okay.
Whatever she decided to do, I was going to be okay with that.
Okay.
And you know, she decided... We talked about this for a couple of years. That was one of the things on her bucket list after she graduated from college. Next is Dancing with the Stars, but anyway.
Telling all your lists. She knows your list. She knows your list.
For me.
Come on, mentally,
yes,
the process.
I'm just not exhaling.
Yeah.
You know, I'm so ecstatic about what God has done in her new life. She actually has a whole new life.
Yeah.
And I was concerned because, you know, you think sometimes when you get something, the blessing.
Yes.
You don't always know how to receive it. I mean, I had to come out and, you know, she's healthy now. She can just, I don't have to worry about her. Mm-hmm. I had to overcome some of my obstacles with her because I was very protective of her.
Course.
And I still am, but now I'm free.
You got some peace of mind?
I have so much peace. Yeah. I am so glad that
describe
she made
that.
The
describe that from, you know, from then to now. Yeah, the peace.
Well, it's the, you know what, I know we are people of faith.
Okay.
And with this, we have always just trusted God. It was hard, but you know, there were just days when I could not. We done everything. She's a vegetarian. She's been a vegetarian for 4 or 5 years. She's hydrated. She really doesn't like to take pain meds unless she needs them.
Yeah.
And I know she does have a high tolerance for pains because that's the last thing she wants to do. And the doctor was always be like, well, why don't you want any pain meds?
Like,
she's
nah.
like, no. But when she needed them, I knew that she needed them.
Yeah.
But and. Just this new life, I just feel very blessed. And I always tell Sierra, I say, you know what? Because it has been a part of our life, we have so much to give.
Yes.
We have so much to offer.
Yes.
And I just hope that the people would receive, because with sickle cell, you suffer.
Yeah.
And there is help available if you want it.
And that's the thing. You don't have to. I mean, when you say suffer, mm-hmm. you got to look at the context of that, right? And if you're living a quality life, you don't have to suffer.
Right.
So it's all described in language. Mm-hmm. You know, we're describing all this whole conversation is in language, mm-hmm. and words mean different things to different people from your environment.
Right.
And
I don't think I had a good quality of life before.
Yeah.
I was scared.
Yeah, definitely.
All the time. Yeah. I just felt like, oh my God, I can't be too far away from a hospital. Yeah. You know, like I don't feel like I had a great quality of life. Yeah. I was living in fear of the unknown. And that was because I feel like everybody lives their life as a result of experience.
Yeah.
And I had experienced so much pain and just chaos. Being in school one moment and then not being, you know.
But imagine having being a painter, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're a painter. What do? They paint on that canvas, and then when that canvas is done and dry, they take that canvas off and they drop it to the side and they put up another new canvas. Imagine living life like a new canvas, and it's possible.
It's possible.
It takes some work.
We're oh yeah.
It takes work, but it is possible to experience life in a whole new realm of possibility with a whole new canvas. And that's what I want to have those conversations so people don't have to feel like they're struggling. Yeah. Like I get the there's a reality to sickle cell, and then there's, you know, what we say it is.
Yeah.
And it doesn't have to be language as a struggle.
Yeah.
That's the whole part of that mindset. And how do we help, you know, like I said, impact that mind. And you said, Kay is, Give them that mental health at a younger age.
Yes,
give
absolutely.
It to them, you know, when they're 5, 6, 7, mm-hmm. because we don't pay attention to kids, mm-hmm. children.
Right.
They're 5. He don't know. Look, shit. Mm-hmm. No, that brain is absorbing everything in that environment.
Right.
So why would it not absorb some kind of tools of mental toughness or whatever that is that you choose in your family to help strengthen that mindset? It doesn't have to be until you're 20. Or 15 or 30, that work could be done earlier.
Early, absolutely.
I'm grateful, though.
Yeah.
Like, I'm, you know, when you're dealing with pain and chronic illness or any painful situation that you're going through, I'm so grateful because I feel so much further along than some of my peers just because I've had to experience a little bit more life, you know, and I just feel grateful because I know what it's like to be in pain, and I know what it's like now to.
Well, your mom said it. You guys are a blessing to this community.
Yeah.
Because you know what that feels like.
Yeah.
And they can't take that away from you.
Yeah.
Even though you received your blessing of having that, you know, transplant, but you are still a part of that community and you know what that feels like, tastes like, looks like. You know that experience, and they can't take that away from you. Yeah. No one can.
Yeah.
But that is what we use to educate others, and even our own community. Because again, some people just believe what they believe, and I've met people that didn't know another sickle cell patient until they was 18, 19 years old. That's real.
Yeah.
So to hear your story, they're like, "What? Mm-hmm. Like I didn't know anybody until I was 18. Like all that?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's the experience is unbelievable when you hear these stories that I've heard over the last 6 years of life experience. And it's common. The one thing is, it's across the board common.
Right.
It's not like someone has a different experience that is left field. No, it is the sickle cell experience is what it is, because that's the reality of it. Yeah. And I think that we could impact the mindset and the points of view of it, which empowers our community to just be mentally tough, you know, tougher.
Yeah.
If that's because that's what it's going to take to have a quality of life is that toughness.
Yeah. Even in the toughness.
Am I pushing it?
Yeah, you're pushing it. Yeah. I'm going to tell you, I'm just being real.
Yeah. Be real with me.
There, I don't have all there the was answers. Just days I didn't want to do this.
Yeah.
I don't, you know.
You was like, forget it.
Yes. I just did not. It was no fun. And I know that I have dealt with depression in this because I felt like I didn't have any control. No one there. And why is she suffering like this? I mean, oh my goodness. And I'm fortunate that I've journaled now for over 30 years.
Yeah.
I journaled and I don't know. I guess God was preparing me for my journey. I think writing does help get understanding. even as Sierra has done, she was the oldest patient out at the City of Hope to do the transplant.
I was thinking that because usually they it's like a younger age, six,
oh,
seven,
yeah,
you
usually,
know.
You know, my journey was kind of crazy. I won't tell anybody about that, but
I can't get the exclusive. You ain't gonna give me the exclusive.
No,
so you're saying it for the book? Is that what's mom? I got you. Mom's gonna save some of that for the book writing.
Yeah, save it for the book.
All right. I'm cool. I'm not offended. I respect it.
That's right.
I respect that.
But you know, actually, I had to get my transplant as a clinical trial in order for them to do it. Because it was considered experimental.
Yeah.
Because I was
your
so
age.
Old.
Yeah, your
you know?
Age.
So it was actually under a clinical trial.
Wow.
So I had to report, you know, all the findings that they were finding during my transplant.
But that is going to change the
future
of that work.
They told me last week when I went to the, I'm getting my immunizations all over again.
Yeah.
All of them. And I was at the hospital last week and my doctor came in and he said, you remember, they thought I was having pain crisis during the transplant. And they thought that it was in my head, that it was like phantom pain.
Right.
When you get your leg cut off and people say they have pain.
Right.
They thought, oh, it's in her mind.
Right.
Like she's got 99% of all the new donor cells.
Yeah.
But the doctor came in and he says, we are finding now that you can still be having some pain up until a year after the transplant. And he said, now, because of what we learned about you with all the pain medicine and all the stuff that you went through when you were in the hospital last year, we've been able to help some of the patients now. So,
because you're sure the body is just that pain is.
Yeah.
It's to the bone, so you can't tell me if there's muscle memory, there's got to be some pain memory.
Neurons.
Right, you see what I'm saying? So the biology of all that behind the inside of there, of course it's.
Yeah.
It just makes sense.
The other thing in that conversation medically is that we have to remember that sickle cell has to do with a change in your genetics, and so. I've always questioned the belief that the only cause of the pain is whether or not those cells are sickling. Mm. Because I think that's part of why you have problems in traits. So there may be other things going on that we don't even realize. So I don't think the pain was in her head at all.
No, that's what I'm saying.
I think if you could have a patient with just traits, go into a pain crisis, then if there's any percent of her normal DNA still present, it's possible for her to have a crisis.
Yes, because it was not 100%. It was like 98-99%.
Wow.
But I also would like for the listeners to know, too, that with bone marrow transplantation, the chemotherapy is not as intense
like
as it used to be.
Yeah.
Like, they're noticing now that if they give you the right amount of chemotherapy to kill off your marrow, even if you engraft, like, 50%, you're still considered with the trait now.
Right, you
cured.
Still have the trait, right.
So
you still have the genes.
Yeah.
So your child can still have the sickle cell.
Potentially, yeah.
Well,
but they said you shouldn't experience any symptoms
of it.
Right.
But because you were SS, that means you can only pass the S, though, right?
Yes.
So your child will automatically have the trait still.
No,
not automatically. I think it depends on who I hook up with. But I still carry the gene.
You have SS, though.
I still carry the gene.
Now, she has SS. That means her children will have at least the trait.
Yeah, your child will at least have the trait.
I'm bringing up is that if they get you. This is one of the reasons the trait conversation is also important.
Yeah.
If they're saying, well, we can get you just to the point of being like someone with trait and you're not going to have symptoms, but then those people still have symptoms, then they'll still be treated like they're crazy and it'll be back to, oh, you're just drug seeking. Yeah. And what I'm saying is that it's very important to realize that with trait, you can still have crisis.
Right.
So there's more to the disease than we fully comprehend. And it's not so much that they're making money off of us, it's that they're not making money off of sickle cell and sickle cell trait patients. So it's not really financially worth it to fully understand that disease or come up with a cure.
What?
And I think it's taken this long to even come up with this much of a cure, you know, because of all the hard work and effort that, you know, people have done in our community.
Right, but you gotta listen. I mean, you gotta hear as well there's the secondary complications of sickle cell, the organ damage and the necrosis.
Oh, yeah.
That's gonna, if that's effect, if does, if those, if they're damaged,
right,
then that's gonna be, could be a lifelong pain anyway. So
right. Even when you're not having a sickle cell crisis,
right,
you're still having complications.
Some kind of, right, exactly. So the secondary, you know, I don't think the community or people that are not educated understand that the secondary complications are just as impactful as having sickle cell
symptoms.
Itself, the
yeah.
symptoms itself. So
yeah.
that's another thing that a part of the conversation has to be addressed and talked about, the secondary health complications.
But at the same time, I think it's wonderful that we can rejoice in knowing that the extreme existence of just something, it sounds like the experience that Sierra had before the transplant was almost just like one crisis to the next. There
yeah.
wasn't a whole lot of let up. It'd be a little bit of time in between, but sometimes not much. Not enough to really feel like she was living.
Yeah.
And it can be that extreme. And if the bone marrow transplant, you know, like, I'm loving hearing you say that I can do hot yoga and I can
right?
get in a cold ocean. And it's amazing. It's just wonderful.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that is what combats the concept of the future of uncertainty.
Yes.
Is being able to focus on those wonderful times that do happen. And you know, the point that her story, that your story really emphasizes is we always have to reserve judgment because, you know, even when you deal with the future of uncertainty, there has to be some good times on the in-between
yeah.
for you
yeah.
for you to combat that future of uncertainty.
So true.
And,
yeah.
and, you know, it sounds like this, the transplant can, you know, depending on how bad off someone is, can give you that, you know, those times that you can concentrate on.
Yeah. Yeah. And you just proved my point, Sierra, as far as, like I said, are you going to be ready? Is your body going to be ready for that transplant? Is it going to be ready for that cure?
Yeah, it's
like,
such a fine line
yeah.
when it comes to the medical industry on if they're going to give somebody the transplant. So I was very fortunate to have a hematologist who fought for me.
Yeah.
You know, he really fought for me to get the transplant because at first.
Because your mom punched him in the eye. She threatened his bucket list.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just very fortunate that he fought for me. He
yeah.
saw that it was something that I wanted. I didn't want to be on hydroxyurea anymore. I didn't feel like it was working for me. And I don't think that hydroxyurea, correct me if I'm wrong, Dr. Maisha, I don't feel like it's been around long enough for us to really know the side effects of taking a chemotherapy drug for a long period of time, what the damaging effects are of that.
Oh, it's been around long enough for us to know that, and we know that it has many damaging effects.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So when you want to be on hydroxyurea, that's valid.
Yeah. Mm. It increases the fetal hemoglobin, but again, you look at the secondary complications.
Right. Yeah.
And that's what you got to be able to, you know, figure out.
It can do everything that the chemo drug that you took for your bone marrow transplant did, and everything any chemo drug is known to do. It can do that. It may take a little bit longer
yeah.
and have to accumulate a little bit longer in your system because they're giving you lower doses than you would give for cancer, but it is a cancer drug. There are patients
yeah.
that I've referred to the hematologist with trait and symptoms and said, hey, do you think this patient could have hydroxyurea so they don't, you know, they don't have to worry about having crisis? And the answer was, no,
really?
I'm not exposing them to the risks of hydroxyurea
wow.
when it's just trait.
Wow.
Yeah. It's like, yes, they may have some crisis a few times a year. And it's a hematologist that knows the trait can crisis.
Yeah.
You know, there may be some damage here and there. But, you know, they wanted to reserve the hydroxyurea for the pretty bad off sickle cell patients because only then did it become worth it to expose this human being to this toxin.
Yeah. Did you have Sierra, did you have any issues with iron overload at all? Or
no, my mom was like...
Uh-oh, what's up, Mom? Not today. She said, not today.
Yeah, pretty much. Every hospitalization I had, you know, since a lot of doctors are not very... I feel like some of them just don't know a lot. That's the first thing they want
to
do. Like,
that's
when
the
you get there,
huh?
They're like, okay, blood
transfusion. Right?
And my mom was like, sorry, you're not giving her a transfusion.
Not today.
No, no. And I was very fortunate that I had her because she
my mom did not ever listen to whatever the doctor said. She never went by, even to the day, you know.
I know who you was listening to. It was a prayer that was on them.
Well, you're still here.
Not today.
She was like, you will not be transfusing her. She'd be like, Sierra, we're going to wait for your hemoglobin to come up. We're going to let give you these fluids. And
wow.
She made them wait.
In the shower.
Yeah. She made me do. I remember I was having a pain crisis one time. And my mom and her research, she was like... She went and got a cup of water, poured like half a container of cayenne pepper in the water.
And you drank it.
She was like, drink it. I'm screaming, call 911. Call 911. I'm in so much pain.
My mouth is on fire. Yeah.
And she's like,
look.
She's like, you're going to drink this. And I drank it. And I kid you not, the ambulance got to the house. And we sent them away because the cayenne pepper in the water worked.
Well, Mom, you went to work on that? Hey,
she did all kinds of like things. Drink, you're going to eat this garlic. Eat the whole garlic. Eat these beets. You know, my mom was the
queen. Get that blood count up.
Yes, that's right. She did all those things, and she didn't just listen to what the doctor said. She did her own research, and she just kind of listened to her intuition.
What would they tell you that when you had a crisis, your count? What was the count?
What was my count? Six, seven?
Sixes, sevens?
Yeah. She,
I mean, I had some, but I had never had enough transfusions to have iron overload.
Yeah.
Well, you could have if we went along with
it. Look, you see, you did all the hundreds of thousands that they wanted to do.
Yes, it's really sad how so many patients that go in and they're in agreement with these transfusions when, you know, a lot of them can just get hydrated and wait. I mean, hydration and weight.
Yeah, we prevention advocates around here.
That's right.
So you got to be able to take care of yourself preventive.
Miss Jackson is amazing.
I know, right?
You
got to be.
Yeah. Miss Jackson.
Yes.
I don't listen to the doctors either. No.
Mm-mm. And she's the doctor.
She's the doctor.
She don't listen to the doctors.
Well, I understand.
Yeah.
She know how some of them are.
Yeah, they all, but I think it's just too, in the doctor's defense, I think that they're scared sometimes because
the liability factor,
they don't, they don't know. And so they're like, okay, we'll just give it to her, even if it's not necessary, because, you know, they don't want to be responsible for anything happening, which is understandable in their defense.
But
the doctors are practicing.
Oh.
In the mentality of the future of uncertainty.
Yes. And exactly. Yeah. They're practicing because I don't want this to happen to you. But you don't know. But I did an event a couple of years back, and he was a doctor out of Riverside, and white doctor, and was like, oh, yeah, the 70 to 100,000, these numbers have been the same since the 70s. And like, but he was straight up with it, right? And he was like, I don't know why the doctors, if the patient, treat the pain.
Right.
Like, if we're about the addiction later.
Yeah.
If it even happens.
Right. Yeah.
So treat the pain. Mm-hmm. Give them what they say they need. If if that's what they've been taking and it's a high dose and you ain't never seen the dosage before, doesn't mean that that's not what they take.
Right.
So he was like on point with it. Mm-hmm. He retired, unfortunately, but he was on point with his conversation. Mm-hmm. Like the percentage of them being addicts is low, man.
Right.
The percentage is actually low.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So give them, treat the pain and then deal with that. You know, afterwards.
Yeah.
But like so she says, some of the doctors are like, some of the doctors are like, nah, they're not going to give it at all because the liability factor or whatever, that uncertainty that their practice isn't, you know, jeopardized or whatever. It could be anything, you know, but how does that take care of the patient?
It doesn't.
Not
at all. If anything, it causes more stress.
Oh yeah.
Not just on the patient, but the hospital staff is gonna get it too.
So what do you do?
Yep.
What do you do on the outside?
They get it.
What do you do on the outside? I'm about to draft you.
On the outside?
Yeah. You retired? You still in the medical field?
I'm a hairstylist.
You still in the medical field?
Yes, I will always be in the medical field.
Dr. Maisha, I'm about to draft you, Dr. Maisha.
I don't know
what organization you're a part of.
Her.
I don't know if you're a part of an organization already or not, but I'm about to draft you in a minute.
Well, that's all good.
We need
I love people.
Yeah,
no one should have to suffer.
Yeah, no. She says,
and I'm about to start telling people to get that cayenne pepper and put it in the water.
Oh my gosh, I can tell you a whole lot of remedies.
The whole remedy. That's going to be in the book, huh? See? Right. Mom ain't going to share none of that, Dr. Right. Maisha. That's for the book.
Listen, those things work.
Yes, they
do. What was it? What were they doing back in the day? Come on. What were they doing back in the day? Right. I'm pretty sure the beats.
The only problem that we have is that we have destroyed the earth, and a lot of the herbs that would take care of a lot of these problems.
Oh, yeah, they're not around no more.
You can't find.
Well, you got to go overseas to get them in the jungle, in the midst of the jungles.
God made a cure for every disease that God created. He made a cure.
I believe that.
You may have to travel to find that cure, but He made a cure. And so this is where we've gone wrong in Western medicine, is to make all these chemicals and ignore
the
traditional healing that would have worked the terrible side effects.
Me and her, we're cool, so we could go back and forth. My point of view on that is two things that you, one thing that you said about the newborn screening. To me, that's still after the fact.
Right.
To me, it's preventive. Have that conversation with that family before they decide to become a family and have children and all that. Like, I think the newborn screening works. Just my view is just as after the fact. Because now within that, if you have to decide if I'm going to abort this baby or if I'm going to keep it.
And that
is another conversation, right? So in preventive, you know, have that couple get educated beforehand. So now if they do have a child, they're prepared. Because they're going to do what they want to do as a couple anyway.
Right.
But at least a lot of families were not aware ahead of time. Like you said, you found out when you were
six months pregnant.
Mm-hmm. But my advocacy work is find out ahead of time.
Right.
Have that conversation with those couples ahead of time, preventive. And then if they choose to have a child after they find out they have the traits and whatever, because you can't love is love. Mm-hmm. And people will still have the child. They'll take that chance. But at least they're more aware. They know what to look for. They know what the resources. They're educated. That's my view. The other view is, Dr. Maisha, what you just said is that goes back to the quality of life. To me, there is a reality of sickle cell. There is the reality of it. Do you want to cure the reality of it? I don't know. That's all God's work. That's all, you know, the trait has a purpose in life. It fights malaria in those parts of the country. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But
We don't have malaria.
So it's all right. So we don't worry about that. So now we're worried about the pain and the crisis. That's our advocacy work here. Over in Africa, their campaigns are all about malaria and mosquitoes. That's what that's what their campaign is all about. Ours is more of the pain crisis and all that. So I got to get out of here. But I just think that there is a reality to sickle cell.
Yeah.
And I think if you could accept the reality of sickle cell, then that could impact the quality of life.
Absolutely.
And that's just the reality of it. Dr. Maisha, thank you for your time. I appreciate you.
Thank you, Dr. Maisha. Can't wait to meet you.
Oh, yeah. She off the chain. Dr. Maisha is no joke. And to my live guests here, I thank you for your time, for coming out for the short notice.
You helped me
set this conversation. I might be done with this conversation now because you just helped me, you know, set it off. So I appreciate you both.
Thank you.
Any last words to the community before I let you go?
I just want to say, be careful who you hook up with. I really am so happy about my bone marrow transplant. I definitely think that it's an individual choice, but I'm so excited about my new life.
Okay.
And I would say for any of the sickle cell patients, stay hydrated and take walks and take care of yourself. You owe it to yourself.
Yeah. And look up those herbs.
Yeah, thank you. All right. This is WDC Radio. I'm your host. I'm WDC. Again, thank you for listening in. I'm out of here. I got to get out of here. I'll see you again on the 29th. That's right. I got a full month this month. So I'll be back on the 29th of October. Catch the social media at IMWDC. I'll be posting stuff about sickle cell trait as I do always. I got the new logo out there for the campaign. Are you having sickle sex? Stop sickle sex campaign. I put a condom on a sickle cell in case you ain't seen it. I know it's risky, but I gotta do it. I gotta draw the attention to it and make people aware. And if I got to put a condom on a cell, that's what I did. So be mad at me.
That's right.
But people are getting educated.
Yes.
Shout us out. What's the count?
Okay, I'm so naive. I didn't know that's what that was.
Oh, you know what, Dr. Maisha? Get off my phone. Bye, Dr. Maisha. Bye. All right. Shout us out. What's the count? Thanks for tuning, listening in.
Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network, original reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.